Okay, good morning everybody. My name is Elena Carletti. I'm a professor of finance at Bocconi University, and I have the pleasure to welcome and introduce Markus Brunemeyer. I have to say it's both a professional and personal pleasure to have this role, given that Markus and I were actually classmates during our PhD at the London School of Economics. And since then, we have always remained in contact. And I have to say, Markus is exactly the same as a few years ago when we did the PhD, despite his professional career. Markus is the Edward Sanford Professor at the Department of Economics of Princeton University. And currently, he also serves as director of the Princeton Bendheim Center for Finance. Markus has an incredible number of affiliation, awards, honors, recognitions. Let me just mention a few ones. He is a fellow of the MBR, of the CPR, but most importantly, he is a Sloan Research Fellow, a fellow of the Econometric Society, and he has received the Bernasser Prize for outstanding contribution in the fields of macroeconomic and finance. He also has collected several best paper prizes from the best journals, like the Journal of Finance, and he has served on the editorial board of prestigious journals. His research has this combination of policy interest and academic excellence. And for policy, apart from being interested in research, he is also affiliated and participates in several advisory groups, scientific committees, like the IMF, the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, the Bundesbank, and the US Congressional Budget Office. So in terms of his research, his main interest is international financial market and the macroeconomy. But I do remember Markus at the very beginning being mostly interested in financial market and the role of liquidity for prices and asset prices. From this, he developed much more broadly, and he is now interested a lot in the interaction among the different pieces of the financial system and the economic system more generally. And in a number of recent papers, he has been starting to be interested in the theory of money and the interrelation between price stability, the sustainability of government debt, and monetary policy. And today, I think his lecture, that I think is called Financial Dominance, is exactly on this topic. So we are looking forward for your speech, and thank you again on behalf of everybody for accepting this.
Thanks a lot, Elena. It's a pleasure to be introduced by you, and I also would like to thank the Governor and the Bank of Italy in general, Governor Visco, for having the opportunity to give this lecture here. So in particular, it's a big, great honor to be able to give this lecture, and I would like to give my lecture titled Financial Dominance. Let me see whether I can... Okay. So as you know probably from the fiscal theory of the price level, there are different dominance arguments. So you have on the one hand, you have fiscal dominance and you have monetary dominance. It depends who is in the driver's seat. Is it more the central bank or is it more the fiscal authority, the government in the driver's seat? And the fiscal theory of the price level says, you know, inflation is affected by both. It's an interplay between the two dominants and depends. You know, it could be that the fiscal authorities are in the driver's seat and hence their impact inflation, or it could be the monetary authority. And there's constantly a game of chicken going on between these two authorities. I would like to enrich the theory and also include the banking sector and also argue that there might be also some financial dominance. And I would like to highlight how the interplay is between the three dominance possibilities. So this will be the focus of this lecture. So let me start with a little overview of what I will talk about. So whenever there's a crisis, then it is the case that there will be some redistributions. So exposed, there's a crisis, losses are made, and somebody has to assume these losses. The question is, who will assume it? And typically, you would like to shift losses to a sector or a part of the economy which doesn't make things worse. So for example, if you shift losses to the financial sector, it could be that the whole thing is amplified and the crisis becomes even more severe. So you're very careful not to shift losses into this particular sector. But of course, knowing that this will occur, you might position yourself as a sector to amplify the initial shock or create this crisis, and you're strategically weak. That's what I mean by financial dominance. So I will go into this and outlining how this will work, the amplification, and how the strategic response of particular sectors is. So you might say, oh, this exposed redistribution of losses is actually a bad thing, but actually it might be a good thing from an ex-ante perspective if you see it as a risk-sharing phenomenon. So it could be that, you know, there are certain losses, and if the losses are always shifted to the party who can most easily bear it, then it's a risk-sharing arrangement, and that's actually a good thing from an ex-ante perspective. And I will go to this as well. And the third point I would like to make is that I want to go in much more depth into government debt issuance, where then you can use the banking sector as a hostage to, in order to commit to repay your debt, but you can also use the banking sector as an insurer who insures against potential shocks. And I want to show this interplay between these two phenomena. And in the fourth, then I will then highlight much more the interaction between financial, fiscal, and monetary dominance, how all these three elements play together. And finally, I will conclude by saying, oh, what is special in a monetary union and what's special within the European context? And I will also then allude to some work I've done with the Euronomics Group, the ESPYS proposal, and how this would help to overcome some of these problems. So let me start with the first point. So the first point is that you have some losses in times of crisis. Some of them are purely temporary losses, so they don't matter much because, you know, you should intervene, a central bank should intervene, but there are liquidity problems and they can be overcome. But some of the losses are permanent, and then the question is, who should assume these losses? Who can absorb these losses? Is it the financial sector? Is it the household sectors? Can I just push it onto nominal savers through financial repressions? I make them bear the losses, or the taxpayer is bailing them out? So somebody has to assume these losses. The losses are there. I have to allocate them somehow. And the question then is, you know, if I push it onto the financial sector, and I can do this by changing private bankruptcy laws, I can change foreclosure rules and all this. The problem then is that actually all these losses will be amplified through two spirals, the liquidity spiral and the disinflationary spiral. And I will be more specific, I will go through these two spirals and explain how they occur. Within the household sector, I can also push the losses onto the household sector. Then the question is, whom do I want to within the household sector? I might actually depress Keynesian demand, because suddenly households don't have so much money anymore, consumption is going down. So I might be very careful not to push it onto households which have a high marginal propensity to consume, so households which consume a lot out of their income, because then aggregate consumption will go down and this will drag the whole economy down as well. So I have to be careful about this as well. I can push it onto nominal savers or onto the taxpayers more generally. And that's essentially when also then some government debt comes into play, if it's not paid immediately by the taxpayers, but by future tax revenues. So let me zoom in first, given that we talk about financial dominance on this financial sector, and let me first show if I were to push losses onto the financial sector, how this would amplify and make things worse. Okay. And how the financial sector knows that and will position itself in such a way to avoid that losses will be pushed on. Actually, I will argue that you would like to, in certain policies, recapitalize the financial sector in times of crisis in order to stabilize the system, and it need not be a bad thing. So let's zoom in and understand a little bit an economy with the financial sector. So here is an economy in a stylized way. So I have two technologies or two sectors. That's a sector producing good B, let's say, and that's another sector producing good A. And then there is a financial sector in between. So if I look at the balance sheet of this good B producing sector, they have the opportunity to sell off some risky claims to the banks. And they sell them all off, and all the risky claims have some idiosyncratic risk, so there is risk which is specific to each particular firm. But the banks, they hold all these risky claims so they can diversify across these firms of technology B or sector B. Think of some real estate, various and regional differences, idiosyncratic risks, which are the regional shocks. And the banks are active nationally, and so they diversify across the regional shocks. And the banks, then they issue some inside money, and the inside money is held by some other firms which are in some other technologies as well. And even these guys who issue some risky claims, some mortgages or something, they also hold some of this inside money. On top of it, there's outside money in form of reserves, and that's also, you know, funded by the banks by issuing more inside money. So that's our economy. That's based, so this work is based on some work I've done with Yuli Sannikov on the I theory of money, where I stands for inside money. A lot of the money these days is created by the banks, and only a little bit is part of the reserves. So it's, we have to understand how this inside money is reacting after a shock. Okay, how's the money multiplier, the credit multiplier, how's it changing after the shock? And so let's just have a shock to the system, and then we split up the shock into four steps. Okay, so instead of having one shock, and how does this shock translate into some amplification? So there's a little shock, and it translates into a big crisis. Okay, so let's have a shock on this real estate sector, or whatever this technology B is, and there will be some losses here. And these losses will also there will be losses on the risky claims because these mortgages can't be paid back, and some there will be some default rates, and then of course this risky claims will be worth less as well. Okay, so the bank suffers losses. So there might be that here, the bank's assets decline by 5%, but because the banks are levered, and the inside money is not declining, this 5% will translate in huge percentage losses in the equity of the banks. So the net worth is going down quite significantly. So this is going down by 5%, the net worth is going down by 50% because of the high leverage. So that's the first step, and now everything is fine. But now there comes the response of the bankers. The bankers say, oh, after the shock, they're much, much more levered. They want to delever their banking system. So what they do is they delever and shrink the balance sheets, so they get rid of some of these risky claims, so there's some deleveraging going on. That's a second step of the four steps I will talk about. This means, you know, they sell off some of these risky claims. The firms have troubles keeping on the real estate or machines, whatever they have. There will be fire sales, the price will go down. And that's the third step, so the price is going down, and this leads to extra losses. Because now suddenly these assets here and these risky claims are worth less because the price is going down, and this leads to further losses, and actually these losses have to be absorbed by the equity of the banks, the net worth of the banks again. Okay, and that's amplified again. And that's what's the liquidity spiral. That's on the asset side of the bank's balance sheet. This initial shock, because of fire sales, because then the asset price will be depressed, leads to further losses. And these further losses then leads to more deleveraging, and this leads to further losses, and there's a whole spiral going through, amplifying the initial shock. This makes the whole situation much worse. So that's on the asset side of the balance sheet. Then it's on the liability side of the balance sheet. When they delever, they also shrink the total supply of money because they don't issue so much inside money anymore. So what does this mean? If there's less money supply, it means that there's deflationary pressure. If I reduce money supply, but money demand is the same or is even going up because there's more risk now in the system, there's actually then deflationary pressure. So that's the fourth step. Then there's deflation going on. But what does deflation imply for the banks? Notice the banks have money on the liability side. They owe money to the households. If there's deflation, it means the value of money is going up. If the value of money is going up, their liabilities, their debt is going up, which actually hits the net worth of the bankers again. Okay? So that's a disinflation or a deflationary spiral. So both spirals actually make the situation worse for the bankers, and the initial shock, which might have been a relatively small shock, like a subprime crisis or something, is translated into a way, way bigger problem because of the amplification on the asset side of the balance sheet through the liquidity spirals and fire sales and so forth, and amplification on the liability side of the balance sheet through the disinflationary spiral. Inflation is going down. This means the real value of the debt is going up, which hurts the banks because they have, you know, money is their debt, which is the household's, you know, money holding, but for the banks, it's their debt. The important thing is that the initial shock, if the banks would have stood still and wouldn't have reacted to it, this amplification would not have occurred. It is because all the banks, after the shock, had a much higher leverage ratio, and they tried to bring the leverage ratio back down, that this amplification is going on. So that's what I call in this paper the paradox of prudence. So each bank tries to be micro-prudent, it delevers, and it creates endogenously risk in the system, it amplifies the risk, which is then macro-imprudent. Okay, so this micro-prudent behavior, this deleveraging, is actually macro-imprudent. And why is this? Because the price process, the drift and the volatility, both of them, each individual bank takes as given. They don't take into account by reacting to this, they also make the situation worse to other banks. And that's in economics, referred to this as pecuniary externality in this framework. Here it's pecuniary externality with respect to the volatility of the price process primarily. And you can draw an analogy to the Keynes paradox of thrift. So just to recall, the Keynes paradox of thrift said, okay, all the households, they're saving less. So each individual household says, I'm saving less. But because each of us is saving less, the income of the others, I'm spending less. Oh, sorry, I'm saving more. Let me correct this. All of the households save more. They consume less. And by consuming less, it means I spend less and others' income is going down. So at the end of the day, even though everybody is saving more, consuming less, they save as a group, they save less in total or euro terms. So let me say this again. So think of an economy with a lot of consumers and savers. Everybody says, oh, there's a crisis, I have to cut back my consumption and save more. But if I cut back my consumption, it means others make less income. So they actually, even though they save more in terms of fraction of the income, the total euro saving is going down. So total saving is actually going down in the economy, even though each individual household tries to save more. And the same thing is going on with the paradox of prudence. It's just not in levels of savings. It's much more in terms of risk. Even though everybody tries to minimize its risk exposure, the total risk in the system is actually going up through endogenous risk, risk which is systemic and is created by the system itself. Okay. Now, what should we do if we have such a circumstance that there's a negative shock and the banks are overly exposed? So the first thing would say, okay, the banks should not be so highly levered because they can't absorb these losses. But let's suppose the banks are so highly levered. One way you could mitigate these things is that, okay, I know the banks will react this way. Let's just recapitalize the banks. And whenever there is a shock, we just inject new money into them, okay? So, and one way one can do this is through regulatory monetary policy, and that's what we call stealth recapitalization. It's not done in an outright way, it's done in a more sneaky way through the back door. So let's suppose there is this negative shock, and this amplification would occur. What you can do is you can cut the interest rate, and by cutting the interest rate, essentially what happens is, if you have a long-term government bond, let's suppose the long-term government bond pays 5% interest every year. It's a 30-year bond, it pays 5% for 30 years. And the short-term interest rate is 3%. If now the central bank decides to cut the interest rate from 3% to 1%, it means the relative value of the long-term bond to the short-term money, which now pays only 1% instead of 3%, the relative value of the long-term bond is actually going up. Okay, so when you cut the interest rate, the value of the long-term bond is shooting up. So what the central bank is doing, whenever there's a negative shock and the bank would go in this amplification mode, they say, oh, we cut the interest rate, and then the banks make capital gains on their long-term bond holdings. Okay? So you recapitalize the banks whenever they make losses, so their losses are much smaller, and this way there's no amplification, the amplification is switched off. You can reduce this endogenous risk. Okay? Whenever there's a positive shock, you hike the interest rate in order to take some capital out of the banks. So you essentially help, you know, to steer the economy and you stabilize the economy by doing this way. Notice, in order to do this recapitalization through the long-term bond, it is very useful to have this long-term government bond out there. And it should be a safe asset. It should not be an asset which might default. Okay, so you would like to have this long-term, default-free long-term asset there because it will create this income and wealth effects. Because this is very different from a traditional New Keynesian analysis, which all works through the consumers, where you cut the interest rate and bring consumption forward, you stimulate the consumption. Here we do monetary policy in order to recapitalize the banks. Okay, there's a negative shock, we recapitalize the banks, there's a positive shock, we take some capital out, and this way it acts like an insurance mechanism. So the central bank is essentially insuring the banking system against these self-inflicted amplifications. Okay. In good shocks, you take capital out. In bad shocks, you put capital in. It's like an insurance company for the banking system. In order for this to work effectively through interest rate policy, it's nice to have this default-free long-term bond. And I will come back to this special feature of the debt again. So this redistribution, I trust, was one example. Monetary policy can do this redistribution, but there are many ways you can do it. So you can also inflate your debt away. You can do some outright default on debt. That's also an insurance redistribution. I mentioned already before, you can also push losses onto the banking sector by saying, okay, now foreclosures, you know, are almost impossible to do, so the losses will travel to the banking sector. Or you can make the private bankruptcy way more soft, so it's very easy for households to go bankrupt, and then the losses have to be borne by the financial sector. So you can redistribute losses exposed in a crisis very easy, and governments will do this quite a lot, and the banking sector might be afraid of that. Okay, I said, okay, oops, when there's a crisis, they will push losses on that. If the banking sector is very healthy, losses will be pushed on the banking sector. If the banking sector is very weak, then the government will refrain from doing this because then it causes all this amplification. And rather than push these losses on them, they will do monetary policy to recapitalize the banks. Exactly the opposite. Okay. So that's where financial dominance comes into play. The banking sector knows whenever we go in a crisis, and it is very healthy, very well capitalized, losses will be pushed on the banking sector. On the margin, it might be, you know, just when the government thinks, what should we do to stabilize the economy? There's a healthy banking sector. Oh, this healthy banking sector can take the losses. We take it away from the household sector and stimulate consumption and put it on the banking sector. So the banking sector says, ex ante, before this happens, let me be weak, because if I'm not weak, I will actually have to deal with all these losses. So it's, in a sense, financial dominance is a defense mechanism against financial depression, so that losses will be pushed onto it. And you can see this, that's a slide I took from Hyun Shin. You can see even before the crisis and during the crisis, the banking sector was still paying out huge amounts of dividends during the crisis, starting in 2007, 2008. And you might say, they were already aware that there were problems. Why do they bring money out of the banking sector? Okay. And that's essentially, they try to be weak because they know if they're not weak, then losses will be pushed on them. If they're very weak, then they even get some recapitalization through indirect channels like monetary policy and so forth. And you might say the other sectors might do this too. The household sector might also knows if we're weak, then actually we can depress consumption. The government knows it, and then it will try to make foreclosure much more difficult, or will give some mortgage releases or other things in times of crisis. But I would argue that the financial sector is way more flexible and organized than other sectors to do this. Okay, that's why the financial dominance, I think, is more important than other elements. Now, this was essentially when we're in a crisis, what happens? Ex ante, you might say, oh, that sounds like very bad. There will be these losses distributed. But you might say, ex ante, it's not a bad thing. So it's like an insurance scheme. If there's no moral hazard involved, and they move things around the financial sector, whenever there is, you know, we have our 10 sectors in the economy, whenever there are some losses in one sector, we push some resources into this sector, and we don't know who ex ante will be in difficulties. So it's an insurance scheme for the economy if something goes wrong. So we'd like to have some contingent commitment, ex ante, some rule, which helps out whatever sector it is when there's a crisis. And this way we stabilize the economy, whenever the problem is in the economy. So the ideal rule, essentially, you would like to have from an ex ante perspective is to have where you look at where's the bottleneck in the economy, which sector is balance sheet impaired. So there will be certain sectors balance sheet impaired. And then I push some resources into this sector. And that's like an insurance scheme that optimizes our risk sharing across all individuals, all sectors in the economy. And by doing this and knowing that this will happen, the amplification will be switched off, there will be less endogenous risk. And this is a chart taken from the I-theory, our paper piece of Yuli Sannikov. You can see if the fundamental volatility is plotted here, you can see that the total volatility, the self-generated systemic risk in the economy is way, way bigger. Okay, so even the fundamental volatility is tiny. There's a lot of volatility coming on from this endogenous behavior, this reaction of the banks to be micro-prudent, but then be macro-imprudent. So the problem of this insurance scheme, like any insurance scheme, is of course moral hazard. So the insurance alters the behavior of the banks, and one is this financial dominance. You try to be strategically weak, and that makes actually things worse. That's the first problem. And the second problem is, can you really stick to such an insurance rule? The insurance rule says, okay, whenever I identify, expose there's a crisis, only in the crisis states, I help only the financially impaired sector, okay? If I make this rule book, and when the crisis comes, do I really stick to my rule books, this time and consistency problem? And how can I commit to such a scenario? So the overall time and consistency problem is, so we have exposed in a crisis, we have this redistribution of losses through monetary policy, explicit bailouts, and this will benefit the sector which can, you know, cause most of the amplification, so this damage through amplification. And then I have an interim stage where different sectors can position themselves in order to get more from the redistribution. That's already a problem. So you have this financial dominance, you pay out dividends, you do some other measures. And ex ante, you would like to promise that you have some redistribution, but it's limited to some extent. It's only focused on the balance sheet impaired, and you don't want to promote some interim optimization of other players and sectors. So this is essentially this time and consistency. You would like to promise and commit to some strategy, knowing that the others will react to it, and actually you might change your mind exposed, given the circumstances. Now, I would like to, this more general rule, this general redistribution in times of crisis, I want to apply it now to government debt. Okay, and I want to understand, you know, what role does government debt play? And I mentioned already, for monetary policy to have an effective redistribution rule, it's very useful to have government debt default free. You want to have government debt as a safe asset. Okay. And one way to do this is to say, okay, I use my banking sector as a hostage. Or I can use it as an insurer. These are the two extremes. But financial dominance will push you to this phenomenon. I will argue what the costs are involved with that. Okay. So debt, government debt, or debt more generally, has a dual role. On the one hand, it provides some opportunity to have liquidity. You smooth your temporary shocks over time. So if you have a temporary shock, now you have a negative shock, you borrow and you stimulate the economy, do some Keynesian stimulus, and you know, that's fine. You can overcome this temporary shock and you pay back later. That's a tax smoothing argument, and what for this you need a default-free bond, ideally. But it has also a second component if you have a solvency shock, if it's a permanent shock. It is also a risk-sharing tool. It's like contingent debt. You would like to have, through some default, you would like to have some redistribution, and defaulting on the bond is a way of redistributing, pushing some of the losses onto the bondholders. Okay. And of course, for this, you would like to have a defaultable bond. On the other hand, I mentioned already beforehand, for an effective monetary policy to redistribute through monetary policy, you would like to have a default-free bond. And there's already this tension here. So you would like, on the one hand, a default-free bond gives you more effective monetary policy, redistributive monetary policy exposed. But, you know, defaulting on the bond is another way to redistribute losses away from, you know, from the debtor to the creditors. And I mentioned already this time consistency problem. What you might want to promise ex ante is very different than what you want to do exposed at the end. And ideally, what you would like to do is you would like to make a commitment saying, okay, I will do in certain states of the world, I will not default, but in certain extreme states, I will default. And I will contrast this with a straitjacket commitment, where actually you cannot fine-tune to do different actions on the based on the states of the world. You can just commit to repay whatever happens. I call this a straitjacket commitment. I will show you what the problems associated with this setting. So for this, let me go in a little toy model. There won't be many equations, but just pictures and graphs to illustrate the problems associated with that. So think of a country or government at time one. It comes with, from time zero, it has to refinance a certain amount of debt. Okay. And now we have to determine what is the face value of this new debt we are issuing in time one. And there will be some default cost. The face value means that's the interest rate we have to offer in order to issue this debt. And then at time two, the world ends, the uncertainty is resolved, the economy has a certain GDP output, which also translates into some primary surplus. So if there's no austerity measures or extra taxes imposed, that X here is just our GDP, or think equivalently the primary surplus, which is just one-on-one related with GDP of the economy, like the income of the citizens. And for simplicity, let's just assume this X is uniformly distributed between zero and X upper bar. You can set X upper bar equals to one. So it's just a uniform distribution. It's the most simple distribution we can. All of them are equally likely. And then at time two, once we know X, the realization of the GDP or the primary surplus, we have to repay the debt, or we might actually do some extra austerity measures or some extra taxes in order to be able to repay the debt. Or we may just default on the debt. Okay. And of course, the creditors who give them money now, they know that this will happen. Now, here is the government debt. So what will happen is, so here is again, is our X, that's our primary surplus, how much the government will in, the income of the government, the revenue of the government in terms of taxes, minus the fixed expenditures they can't change. That's, you can think of, yeah, the surplus, and here's just the 45-degree line, slope of one. If the government promised a face value of this level, let's say some certain amount of value, that's what the creditors get back. So given that it's uniform here, the area underneath is just the expected payment. I also assume that if there is default, so if the income is less what the government is promising, then there will be default in this area here. Okay. Now, the default probability, hence, is given by this thing here, by this area. So that's a default probability. But even if there's default, I assume there still is a recovery rate on the bonds, so that you still have to pay something. And the assumption is that you will pay something back, which is below the 45-degree line. So if you have an income of, you know, let's say, 50, you only pay back 40 because there will be some extra bankruptcy costs and verification costs. So that's this wide area here. Okay. So the payoff structure the bond investor faces, and he thinks, oh, I don't know what X will realize tomorrow at time two, but I will get something like what's on this red line. When the expectations, I get something which is given by this lightly red something area. Okay. So that's what the bond investor says, okay, that's what I will go back, get back, and this is the default probability, and then I get less back than the face value the government promised me to pay back in time two. So now let me put the face value here, so it's the same face value here, and I said, okay, how much do I get back to this area here, and I plot this on this new x-axis over there. That's the refinancing potential. So if I offer this face value, if the government offers this face value, it gets at most, it gets back this dot here. So this, here's the same face value going over there, and this here I plot just on the x-axis the area here underneath. Now the government might say, oh, I need more money, let me offer a higher face value. So let's say, oops. The government says, oh, I offer this higher face value. But then, of course, the government will not default only if X is in this area, and now in this whole area it will default, and the payoff is, you know, then given by this gray and the red area, excluding this triangle here. That's now the new expected payoff. Okay, if there's default, let's say X turns out this, it will be the payoff will be this. If it's X turns out that. So the bondholders, and I assume that they're risk neutral and they're happy to finance the government, but they're in expectations they get this area back, and that's, you know, for this face value to move over there, and this area is now this on this x-axis. Okay. So that's for higher phase value. And I can do this for all the different phase values. Then I get the whole graph. And it turns out to be a parabola in the simple example. So it's something like this. Okay. So if the phase value goes up, the government can raise more money from the debt holders. But if the phase value goes up too much, then actually how much it can raise is actually going down. Okay. Why? Because, you know, this bankruptcy cost thing is becoming bigger and bigger as well, and this actually pushes the force in the other direction. Okay. So that's how much you can raise. And you can see there's a maximum here. So you can choose the phase value. There's a maximum in this region. If you start with time zero, you come up from time zero, you come in time one with a certain debt. If your debt level is below this, then you're solvent. If it's above that, you're insolvent. You can't do anything. You can't raise so much money to repay back your old debt from time zero. But you also notice something else. There are two levels here. So there is a good equilibrium and a bad equilibrium in a sense. So in the good equilibrium, you offer this phase value, and you can raise the same amount. But you can also offer a much higher phase value, this one, and then you get the same amount, okay? So you would offer a much higher interest rate, a much higher phase value, and you don't get more than this. And you can get stuck in this bad equilibrium compared to this good equilibrium, okay? So, if you look at the slope of this arrays which go through this point, this is the interest rate, this corresponding interest rate. So you have one equilibrium with a lower interest rate, where you're here, and there's another equilibrium with a high interest rate, but you raise the same amounts of funds, okay? And that's where there's illiquidity coming in. In this branch, you have some illiquidity, so there are two equilibria, one liquid equilibrium and one illiquid equilibrium, okay? So you raise the same amounts, like, I don't know, $1 trillion or euros, and you know, one you have to pay a much higher interest rate, and the other one you have to pay a much lower interest rate. Of course, next period you will be much worse off if you're in this bad equilibrium. And this illiquidity phenomenon you want to stay away from, because there's no benefit from that. So how can you do that? Can you commit to be in this and say, okay, I commit only to this default probability, and I pay back, and I can stay in this good equilibrium? Okay. If your refinancing needs is in this area, you're insolvent, there's no hope anyway, you have to restructure. But if you're in this, there's a possibility that you're in this liquid or this illiquid equilibrium. But you're solvent, and in this area, you're solvent and liquid, in this area here. Now, one way to say, okay, I go straight out to the investors and say, I will pay back whatever happens. I make a straight jacket commitment, okay? And then you get rid of this illiquid equilibrium, okay? So instead of saying, I promise you a phase value of F, and whatever happens, whatever X is, I will pay it back. Okay, then the payoff for the bondholders is this area. Think of this as slope of one, then how much you can raise for this phase value, you go up here and go down here, it's just a straight line. You can raise much more. It didn't fit on the slide, so I had to break it here. But this is squeezed together, so you have to stretch it out again. So your solvency region is much, much bigger if you just commit to pay back everything. Now, the problem with this is that you have to pay back something, you promise to pay back something, and you don't have it. So there's a shortfall. You know, your GDP only turned out to be here, your tax revenue is only here, and suddenly you promise to pay back more than this. What do you do? So you have to raise new taxes. You have to put in some emergency taxes or some emergency austerity measures in order to get this money, if this really happens. Okay? And this causes some distortionary costs in this state, because you promise to pay back even though you don't have it. You have to go out and do some emergency measures, emergency taxes, or emergency cuts in the budget, and so forth. And the assumption here is that this doesn't come without cost, because you have to deviate from the optimal tax policy. So the shortfall needs to be financed through some austerity measures or emergency tax hikes. So if you fall if I want the plot here, so here's again the axis, if you fall short, then you have to, there will be additional distortionary costs, and they are essentially a function of the surplus, which is a negative number here. So here it's, so there will be distortionary costs if there's a shortfall or a negative surplus, there's this additional cost coming up. So for very low realizations of X, this cost might even go to infinity, okay? I said, oh, that's a problem. I've solved my liquidity problem, but really, in these bad states of the world, I will be in really much worse off. Now, and I might not be willing to do this, so I have to commit myself to really pay in these bad states. So one thing I could do is I can offer my banking system as a hostage. So I say, okay, if I don't repay my debt in these bad states, and do the emergency measures and all that, I will actually sacrifice my banking system, and if I sacrifice my banking system, the whole economy will go in a tailspin. So actually I will do that. So here is the way I offer the banking system as a hostage. I will actually stuff the banking system with the sovereign debt, and I have to pay it back, otherwise if I don't pay back, if I default on it, the banking system is going down, and with it, you know, the whole economy. So no matter what, I will pay it. So it's like, oh, I put a certain commitment cost C, some default costs, which is not only borne by when I default on the citizen, on the banks, but also citizens, because the whole GDP is tanking. So when I think about it, so how should I default? And I will default only if the austerity costs and the repayment I have to do exceed this commitment costs and what I have to pay back then. So let me look at this. So I default if the austerity costs plus, so if I don't default, if I default, I have to pay the commitment costs C, and I still have to pay back my X, okay? That's what I promised, I mean, I have to pay back. So that's what I have to pay back when I default. If I don't default, I have to do all the emergency measures, that's costly, and I have to pay back my full face value. Okay, so let's just plot this. Let me bring this F on the other side. So let's plot this. This is my emergency tax here. And then I have the C plus X, that's this thing here, minus F on the other side. Sorry, there's a little bit of math now. So that's my, essentially, the cost of defaulting. If I change C, if there's more commitment cost, this thing is going up. So you might say, oh, that's actually an interesting picture. So it gives me here my default probabilities. I will nevertheless default. So in order to make sure that I default less, I have to just have to crank up the C and the whole thing moves up. Let's see how this plays out. Let's suppose the C, the commitment cost, is going up. So I destroy more of the banking sector, make it more tight, stuff more government bonds into the banking sector. And you know the way it works through the banking sector is through this diabolic loop. There's more sovereign debt risk on the banking sector. The bailout probability goes up, and so forth. You have this diabolic loop. I will come back to this in a minute. So I increase this commitment cost, and financial dominance will actually, banks themselves will do it. They will increase the commitment cost endogenously by making themselves weak, and the commitment costs will go up. So what happens then? The commitment costs go up, and you say, yeah, that's actually not bad, because now the old default probability was this, where this dashed line is coming down. Now the C is moving up. Now we're in this intersection. Now this default probability is actually going down. So I have to do more austerity measures, but the default probability is coming down. Okay, that's actually a good thing. This means lower verification, low bankruptcy costs, because I don't default so often anymore. It also means a lower face value. A lower face value means a lower interest rate. A lower interest rate means, oh, that's pretty good, because a lower face value here moves this thing up again, and this lowers the default probability even further. So the interest rate is lower that I will default, then subsequently is even lower, because I haven't promised so much to pay back. So there's this nice loop there where I say, okay, actually this lowers my default probability and makes everything less costly. But it comes with a catch. So the default probability is going down, and with it, the interest rate you have to pay and the face value you have to pay. But if you still default, then you have this higher commitment costs. You have to ruin your banking system. You have to ruin the whole economy. So this will be a much bigger catastrophe. You can think of C for catastrophe. And if you're in this austerity region, so there's a region where you default, then you have to pay the catastrophe cost. In this austerity region, you have to impose now much higher tau cost. Okay, these austerity measures are much more severe. So if you think about it, how this strategy works to stuff your papers in the banking system is like a doubling down strategy. It works if it's like you're in a crisis, you know, let's double down. If we come back out, it paid off well, and it's working out well. But if it don't come back up, it will be much worse. It's like a classical double down strategy. Okay. So okay, that's a trade-off a policymaker has to make. I will, you know, I commit myself to pay, but if it goes wrong, then subsequently I will be in much, much bigger troubles. But most likely they come back up, and then it will be a better situation than if I would have not committed to that. Now, this is only half of the picture. So when I showed you this picture about the diabolic loop, I was beforehand. This diabolic loop allows you that to do this because the sovereign risk is connected with the banking risk. I offer the banking system as a hostage, and then the bailout probability. So this was this outer loop. But there's an additional element of this dynamic, of this diabolic loop, which goes through the tax revenue. So if I stuff the banks more with sovereign debt, it happens that the loans to the firms is actually going down, which decreases the tax revenue, which makes the sovereign debt risk even going up. So there's a second loop going on inside. Essentially, if the banks primarily lend to the government and they don't lend to the real economy anymore, it's actually not a good thing because then the real economy will shrink, and because the real economy will shrink, the tax revenues are shrinking, and the sovereign at the end is in trouble nevertheless. Okay, so I think I would argue the second loop is actually even more important because by allowing the banks to, or giving them some treatment, some preferential treatment to lend to the government, you hurt the real economy. By hurting the real economy, you also hurt the tax revenue the real economy is generating for the government. Okay, and it's not clear at all that this is advantageous for the government ultimately, because one is a much more direct channel. Everybody can see, you know, it's just favor the lending to the government benefits, but there's an indirect, you disfavor the real economy, which lowers the tax revenue, which then hurts the government again, which is an indirect channel, and often policymakers put more emphasis on direct channels than indirect channels. So let's look at this second diabolic loop. What does it do? So remember, this was our picture. I took all the previous things a little bit out, so it cleaned up the picture a little bit. Now, if I increase the commitment cost C, which means not only in case of default now I have to pay this commitment cost, but even if we don't default already at time one, the banks will not lend so much anymore to the real economy. So credit growth is going down. Now this means essentially the GDP is going down because credit growth is going down. So the whole X thing is now shifted, where it was the X distribution was here, now it's shifted to the left. Okay, and this means the default probability, which seems like from the direct effect was actually going down, is actually not going down at all. It's actually going up. Okay, so it's because of the whole distribution shifting towards the left. So because of that, the verification costs are going up again. There's more default. The bankruptcy costs are going up. And the face value I have to offer, the interest rate I have to offer, is actually going up. And then the same loop I had before, which was an advantageous loop, is now becoming a disadvantageous loop again and makes the whole thing worse. So the second diabolic loop going through the tax revenue is actually working in the opposite direction. If I don't have the second loop, I can make the case, oh, that's a good thing, it's a doubling down strategy, but I'm happy with a doubling down strategy because I'm hopeful that the economy is coming back, and I go for a doubling down strategy, which is on itself risky, but the second loop says, oh, actually this doubling down strategy doesn't work because I ruin my real economy in the meanwhile. So that's essentially what's written here. The second, the GDP doubling diabolic loop can undo all the benefits we talked about beforehand. Now, so essentially, say, should I take the banks as a hostage? Is this hostage commitment? Is this the right way to go? I should say, I cannot control the C cost because the C costs are actually given by the banks. If the banks become more undercapitalized, if they strategically choose to pay out dividends, they will choose the level of commitment, and they go much more into straitjacket commitment. So I can only go to a straitjacket commitment that I pay back, and if something goes really wrong, I might, you know, have to put extreme emergency measures on in order to pay back the debt. So it has the advantage of reducing the liquidity problem. It lowers the default probability at the lower, but if it fails, I have this doubling down strategy. And this is a painting where somebody drives a Ferrari. That's from Marco Pagano's father's drawing. It's a real Pagano. And you see that he takes off the seat belts and he says to the policeman, I drive without seatbelts because it commits myself not to drive so fast. And this way I will behave better. And the policeman, I don't know what he will say. That's up to the reader to decide. So essentially this doubling down strategy works through this commitment, but essentially commitment is decided by the banking sector. But the second diabolic loop essentially is making things worse. It goes in the opposite direction. So it is essentially setting up a system where there's no safety valve in place. Now, you might say, that's fine. Let me just sell these bonds to somebody else. I will sell the bonds to other investors. I don't sell it to the banking sector, okay? So I sell it to foreign investors, and I can default on the foreign investors. I can sell it to some voters, my domestic households. The problem is when the crisis starts to become more severe, the weak banks will buy back these government bonds. And why is that? Because they can actually enforce that the default probability is going down. So even though initially when you issue the bonds as a government, you might say, I sell it to foreign investors, I might sell it to households, and if something bad comes, I can default on it, and then actually, you know, some of the losses will be pushed on these foreign investors. But when the crisis is around the corner, then the foreigners will sell it to domestic banks because the domestic banks are willing to pay more for these bonds because saying, if I buy it, I can make sure the government will not default. So the willingness for a domestic bank is actually higher than the willingness to pay for a foreign investor, so the government bond will travel back. There's a renationalization going on of this government debt because the domestic banks can ensure that the default probability is low. So even if you sell this government bond to other investors outside of the banks, if the banks later can acquire it, that actually doesn't help at all. And the foreigners might have only bought it because they know they can actually pass it on to domestic banks later on. So this leads me to the other way the financial sector can help. So the first way was, you know, the financial sector offers itself as a hostage for being as a commitment device. And there's some value to it, and it's a doubling down strategy, and they might work out for certain parameters. You might want to go for this doubling down strategy. The other thing is exactly the opposite. And so you use the financial sector as an insurance. So the financial sector is healthy enough so you can push some losses onto the financial sector if you need it. So you can provide some rollover risk insurance if you can't issue, so you can issue more short-term debt, but also some solvency risk. So if the banks are sufficiently well capitalized, you can more easily default on it, and they have some loss absorption capacity without being things. So of course, financial dominance will rule this out. So the banks will try to avoid that, and you know, be weak then when the losses will be pushed onto them, and you need some regulation to enforce that. So these are essentially two different models how you might want to use the banking sector, either as a hostage. You have then a weak banking sector in times of crisis, and it gives you a commitment not to default. There's no way you can default, or you use them as an insurance. It's exactly the opposite. You are able to push some losses, and the banking sector is healthy enough to absorb these losses. Okay. Of course, ex ante, the banking sector will be compensated. You have to give him a higher interest rate because the banking sector is bearing this risk now, and you have to pay for that as a government. Okay, so you offer a high interest rate, the banking sector gets a high interest rate. If there's no default, the banking sector benefits. If there's a default, the banking sector have to take these losses. The banking sector is assuming some of this risk, and you have to compensate the banking sector for this risk. Now, I think that's the key, and there's also, of course, a lot of policy debate, which of the two models you want to go for. So let me now step back a little bit and say, I've talked a lot about financial dominance. I would like to link it to fiscal and monetary dominance. Essentially, the term financial dominance, I came to the idea because of this fiscal and monetary dominance, which is in the fiscal theory of the price level literature. So there is the problem that typically, you know, it might be that the government cannot commit to pay back its debt, or it might not be able to commit not to inflate its way out, and so forth. And typically, this commitment problem you have, the typical solution for this is to split the government into two units. Okay, so you have one government, and then what you do is you split the government in the fiscal authority, the actual government decides about the budget, and some independent central bank. Okay, so you give some power to some technocrats or some people who have a more long horizon perspective, and you split it apart, and this you overcome this commitment problem. Okay, so the institutional design is rather than using the banks as a hostage or something, you outsource it to some independent authority. Okay, and the central bank is this independent authority. What the literature of the fiscal theory of the price level does, they essentially say either the fiscal authority dominates or the central bank dominates. I think what's more, a better description of what's going on, there's an interesting, in times of crisis, an interesting game going on between these two authorities. And you can describe it as a dynamic game of chicken. So there's, you know, who is chickening out first? And you try to push losses on the monetary authority, and then they have to go their way out with inflation, or you push the losses on the fiscal authority, and they have to raise taxes or cut expenditures. None of the two authorities want to do what's needed. Somebody has to assume the losses. And that's why you have this dynamic game going on. But at least otherwise, you would be immediately caught in this commitment problem. Here, you have at least have some game going on exposed. So the monetary dominance essentially means the monetary authority is in the driver's seat. The fiscal authority has to adjust its budgets by either raising taxes or lowering expenditures. Fiscal dominance means the inability or unwillingness of the fiscal authorities to control long-run expenditures to GDP ratio. And this limits monetary authorities to raise interest. So you can think of you know, the fiscal authority says, we don't cut back our budget at all. It's non-sustainable. We know it's non-sustainable. You deal with it. And if the monetary authority wants to raise interest rate, the budget situation will be even worse. The fiscal authority says, we go into more debt. No problem. And at some point, the monetary authority is caught and has to fund, essentially, the fiscal situation. Financial dominance is essentially the inability or the unwillingness of the financial sector to absorb losses, and I talked about this already, is the refusal to issue new equity in times of crisis in order to be able to absorb losses or even pay out dividends in the early phase of the crisis, 2007, 2008. The payout of the dividends were still high. And then you have to redistribute wealth, you have to recapitalize the financial sector, and it can occur either through fiscal recapitalization, or it can occur to redistributive monetary policy, and I talked about this in the beginning. And essentially, there was initially traditional literature has this game of chicken, but now there's a second game of chicken between the central bank and the fiscal authority. Who should recapitalize the financial sector? And should it be done through the fiscal measures, or should it be done through the central bank, through monetary and other measures? Okay, and that's essentially your the traditional game of chicken, but in this world with the financial sector, which the initial literature, there's no financial sector, there's a second game of chicken going on between the two. And you see letters going back and forth, do this, do that, and at the end, the central bank will either do it or the fiscal authorities will do it. And I should say, if it's only a liquidity problem, of course, it's always the central bank which should do it. Now let me translate it into what happens in the currency union and go to the ASBs. So what is a currency union? A currency union is essentially, in one way you can see it, is we get rid of some safety valves. So we have the inflation, everybody knows inflation. We have an exchange rate movement, which is some flexibility to absorb shocks, country-specific shocks. And in a currency union, we got rid of this safety valve, and you know that's a good thing. We also have cross-border flight to safety capital flows to deal with. And now we got rid of, we essentially made a straitjacket commitment with respect to exchange rate. That's when the euro came into place, and we all have, you know, no exchange rate flexibility anymore. So now we need, essentially, we need some, the question is, should we give up some other safety valve, and how many safety valves can we give up? And as I mentioned before, the government debt can act as an insurance instrument if you have some possibility of default without dragging your whole economy and the bank down, and you need certain, in certain extreme crisis states like situation in Greece, you need some restructuring possibilities, otherwise the economy is not coming back out of the crisis. On the other hand, if you want to do some redistribution and some Keynesian stimulus, you would like to have some safe asset without a default. So you want to have two things. You would like to have government debt default-free in order for monetary policy to be very effective to redistribute, and have some Keynesian stimulus financing. But you also would like, for extreme circumstances, you would like to have some restructuring possibility. Okay. And so to achieve that, that's what a group called the Euronomics Group and has proposed, is this ESBIS, the European Safe Bond, where you essentially can do both. The idea is essentially you pool the sovereign bonds of all the countries up to 60% of GDP, up to a certain level. And then you issue a senior bond and a junior bond. And so there's a European senior bond and a European junior bond. So let's suppose there's a default, Greece defaults on something. Some of these bonds will go away and will be lost. But these losses will be absorbed by the junior bond. And the junior bond protects the senior bond. Okay? So you have a safe asset, which is protected by the junior bond, but you still have the possibility in extreme circumstances to restructure. Okay, so in the Greek example, you can restructure in order to get the economy back on its feet, but the safe asset will not be destroyed. So you have both of these elements which you wanted to have by creating the senior bond and the junior bond. Now it has, of course, this ESBIS structure has another big advantage, especially for peripheral countries. It is the flight to safety premium. So what's going on at the moment, this goes a little bit beyond the scope of this theme of financial dominance. At the moment is when the crisis becomes more severe, there's huge capital outflow from periphery into the core. And that's why, you know, the German Bund is has a very low yield, and it's giving a preference to the flight to safety assets like the German Bund or the US Treasury. And they're benefiting from that. And the question is, how can one redirect the flight to safety capital flows, which are now go across borders, to flight to safety capital flows, which go not across borders, but go from one European entity to another European entity? Okay. So essentially, this ESBIS structure, what will happen is that instead of this flight to safety going across the borders, they will actually go out of the junior bond into the senior bond. The junior bond suddenly will see outflows. It's a European junior bond, and it goes in the European senior bond. Okay? But both are European bonds, so the flight to safety premium is shared across Europe. It's not concentrated in certain core countries. It's shared across Europe. So it's a sharing of the flight to safety premium. Typically, Germany enjoys and other northern countries enjoy. And that's essentially which would, you know, share the flight to safety premium across all of Europe, and it would give a benefit, especially to peripheral countries. So let me come to a conclusion. So what I wanted to get across in this financial dominance lecture. Whenever there's a crisis, there will be losses. There are permanent losses. Somebody has to absorb these losses. That's just the truth, and often we want to kick the can down the road, but somebody has to absorb these losses. The policymakers have the difficult choice to say who should absorb these losses, and there are certain sectors which have an amplification threat. They can say, if you push the losses onto me, I will amplify things and make things even worse. So people will not push losses onto that sector. Knowing that, certain sectors will position themselves to say, okay, don't push the losses onto me, I will amplify and make things worse. Okay, and that's what they call financial dominance. And that's a rational response by these sectors. And you know, that's why one has to be prepared for that. Redistributing wealth exposed might seem like it's not a good thing to do, but ex ante, whenever you have, you know, a certain number of sectors and there are some losses in some sectors and some sectors are balance sheet impaired, helping out the sector, whatever the sector it will be, where the bottleneck is ex ante, from an ex ante perspective, it is a risk insurance policy and actually improves welfare. It can be welfare, it's very much welfare improving. So you would like to commit as a government, you know, whenever some sector is in difficulties, I will help this sector out, I take resources from other sectors into that. Okay? Of course, it's a very tricky thing. There will be a lot of lobbying effort and all these things to have this, so it has to be a very objective rule and has to be, to some extent, very much committed upon. Then I moved on and said, okay, government debt. How can I use government debt as a commitment device to commit to do the right thing? And government debt has a dual role. I can either use, you know, I can overcome some temporary liquidity problems by issuing default-free bonds. If I have a default-free bond, I can have very effective monetary policy to redistribute wealth into the banking sector, out of the banking sector. But occasionally, I have to do some debt restructuring because otherwise I won't get the economy off the ground again. The tendency of financial dominance is that if I use the banks as a hostage, financial dominance will lead to the phenomena that there is too much commitment not to default. I cannot restructure, and I cannot, once the bad realization occurs, I'm really stuck, and I cannot get out of this situation anymore. And that's a problem with using the banks as a hostage by, you know, asking the banks to, or giving preferential treatment to hold a lot of government debt. The other option is to make banks loss absorbers and enforce them to have enough capital that they can absorb the losses. But then I have to pay them ex ante for providing the service of giving losses. This means a higher interest rate in normal times. But of course, they also provide the service if some really things bad happens, they will absorb these losses. I cannot ask foreigners. If foreigners or other investors would say, oh, I offer the services, the debt will travel back before the crisis to the domestic banks. So I have to really regulate the domestic banks. That's the secondary market dilemma. To the secondary market, this will travel back. Then I said, okay, how does this financial dominance, where the banks strategically stay weak and pay out dividends or don't raise equity, interplay with fiscal and monetary dominance, the two traditional concepts of dominance? And I said there's a game of chicken going on, and once you have a financial sector, there's a second game of chicken going on. Who should, in times of crisis, channel resources into the financial sector? And then there's a special phenomenon within the currency union, like the European Monetary Union, where you have given up already some safety wealth, like the free exchange rate movement. Now, if you go to full commitment, you give up more safety valves, and then you have to see, is there some structure? And I refer to the ESBs, European Safe Bond Structure, which gives you both a safe asset to do monetary policy, but at the same time, you also have some possibility to restructure in extreme circumstances. And then the losses will be eaten by the junior bond. And it has this interesting good side benefit that the flight to safety capital flows don't go across borders. They go from the junior European bond to the senior European bond. So the flight to safety premium benefits are shared across all of Europe. So let me conclude with that. Thanks a lot for your attention.
So thank you, Mark.